productivity movement, which was popular in the manufacturing sector in the United States in the 1920s, 30s, 40s. Then after the war, World War II, the US provided massive reconstruction assistance to Europe, called the Marshall Plan, which was very expensive. So the assistance evolved from the expensive material assistance to the less expensive technical assistance featuring productivity movement. And with the expectation that the productivity improvement would increase profits and the reinvestment of profits, and the increase in salaries and wages, and the reduced prices of goods and services, so that inclusive growth would be achieved, and so that Western European people wouldn't go to communist. And then after the Korean War in early 1950s, it came to Japan. US government funded Japan strategically very important. So they established the Productivity Center in Tokyo in 1954. And then from Tokyo, the productivity movement was transferred to other Asian countries. And then compared with European people, these East Asian people are really took the productivity movement seriously. Maybe because the East Asian people are serious like this. But also the business leaders like Mr. Toyota, Mr. Honda, founders of Sony, and also political leaders like Lee Kuan Yew of Singapore or Mahathir in Malaysia believed in this way. So to have successful industrial development, developing countries have to improve productivity at least as fast as the rest of the world. But this is possible only if both workers and managers are willing to learn new ideas and acquire new skills. But in those days, people in East Asia was not like that. So the productivity movement would be a set of practical knowledge and know-how and conducive to such transformation of people. So the leaders thought so. So they are very enthusiastic about accepting this kind of movement or philosophy and a set of practical ideas. And then in recent economics literature, as you know, there are many interesting papers about management. These are named few. But increasing number of papers saying that management is a major determinant of productivity. And although this is just the same view held by the US government officials 60 years ago, who brought the productivity movement to Europe and Asia. But of course, in those days, there are no empirical evidence. But these days, we have empirical evidence. And more recently, a number of randomized controlled trials and non-randomized interventions have been conducted to address these questions, like can management be taught to entrepreneurs in developing countries, or can it really improve productivity in developing countries? And then these studies commonly find that the majority of business owners and managers are unaware of standard management practices. So Sam Jones just said access to education is not equal to learning. But similarly, operating business is not equal to having management skills. And then training of management improves management practices. But unfortunately, the training may or may not improve business performance in terms of the sales revenue or value added, the profit, significantly. In some experiments, it significantly improved, but in some very weak. So I have conducted RCTs and non-randomized interventions in Ghana, Kenya, Ethiopia, Tanzania, and Vietnam in collaboration with World Bank and JICA, Justin Lin or John Page, Hin Lin, my sponsors. Then Yeah, after World Bank, then JICA came to me and then offered kind of sponsorship. Before, the JICA didn't listen to me at all. But but then obtained the very similar qualitative results. Okay, so here is an example from Vietnam, but let me skip this interesting picture. If I have time later, I will come back. So then what I we taught was, you know, how to make it habit to keep workplace neat and tidy, to maintain machinery, and to keep records. Not the importance of doing these obviously important things, because almost everybody knew that. But they didn't know how to do that, or how to induce, how to motivate people to, you know, make this as a kind of habit. And more generally, so trainers taught managers how to make workers and managers themselves more productivity conscious, quality conscious, and proactive in learning new ideas and acquiring new skills. So here's a typical result. So, okay, I have, in this case, in Vietnam, I had the four groups. So the group four, the most right-hand side, they are the control group. And then we had the two different type of treatment. One is theoretical classroom training. The other is more practical on-site training. And then 32 enterprises receive both. And then this number is a difference from the average of control group. So on the scale of from 0 to 11, the management practices are, you know, measured. And then the average of control group was this low. But after 2 years later, the training program, so this treatment group had 4.1 point higher than the average of the control group. So management practice became was improved. But you know, performance like value added, evidence is very weak, just 10% significant. Well, of course, this is just intention to treat. So if we replace this another group of the people who actually received training, the result would be a little bit better. And maybe because of small sample, even before the situation before is not really equal, but some failure in randomization. But if we take difference in difference, then result may look a little better. But anyway, evidence is weak about you know, performance. But don't worry about this weak result, because we obtained another interesting result like this. So willingness to pay for training was initially very low. But after training, those participants in training had very high willingness to pay. So this indicates that those who need to learn about management do not know the value of learning. So after receiving training, they want to receive more training. They want to learn more about management. So maybe better to have an introductory course, and then for those who have learned and those who got interested, we will provide the advanced course. That will be better way. And then training program with better design and contents. I think if we, so these economics researchers are really, you know, lay persons about management. So we just were very happy to provide a training program. But we didn't pay much attention about what to teach and how to teach. But if we improve the contents of training, then we will have a better result about management. About the business performance as well. So then, assuming that this kind of training would be very useful and effective, then the next you know, issue would be how to diffuse, how to disseminate this kind of knowledge. And then usually the diffusion of new knowledge or new technology follows this kind of S-shaped curve. Okay? But there are lots of empirical studies about that kind of diffusion process, but those are about a particular technology, a particular product. And the productivity movement is a movement, and also this is very, you know, broadly applicable knowledge. So things may be a little bit different, but let's assume that the diffusion process would be like this S-shaped curve. And then we can foresee these problems like in the initial stage because people do not know the value of learning. So awareness is very important. Publicity would be important. And then if the productivity movement can be potentially very useful, but if the concept is not too much abstract, or the way of teaching is not good, then the people wouldn't accept that. So if there are these problems, then this process would be more prolonged. Or this rapidly diffusing, spreading phase, if the number of trainers are in short of the demand, then we will have this kind of saturation stage much earlier when the diffusion rate is still low. Or the, this is a kind of training or a transaction of knowledge. So there is a, asymmetric information problem. Those who want to learn do not know the quality of the trainer. So if the quality assurance is not established, then the people do not want to learn much. So the failure case would be, the diffusion rate would be like this. So then I looked into the kind of the history of the process of diffusion in Japan, Singapore, or other East Southeast Asian countries, and also I'm involved in the diffusion of the management training in Ethiopia and Tanzania. So I have some experience, but let me focus on Japanese case first. So in Japan, the concept of productivity movement was enthusiastically accepted by large firms first. And then, but the labor unions were reluctant or opposed to the introduction of this kind of thing for the fear of increasing unemployment. So to break this constraint, the large firms had to devise ways in which everybody can participate in the productivity movement and feel good effects immediately. And those firms expose analytical tools to workers so that workers themselves could find solutions and suggest improvements. So this bottom-up version of the productivity movement came to be called Kaizen in Japan. And later in the 1980s and 90s, it was imported by the US automobile industry under the name of lean manufacturing. So in the case of Japan, the large firms did a good job spontaneously, so not dependent much on the government. But the diffusion of Kaizen among small and medium enterprises was delayed. It was difficult. So until the mid-1970s, Japan was said to have a dual economy consisting of modern large farm sector and the backward small and medium enterprise sector. But the spread of Kaizen was underway in those decades. And in the mid-1980s, SMEs came to be viewed as bolstering the strengths of Japanese economy. So this was a typical, master Lars Turner, was the owner of a small business. But they transformed themselves into a kind of modern type managers. So let's be patient. So if it takes time in Africa, so they have. So I found the cigarette sword. And then in Japan, as the diffusion rate increased among SMEs, there were institutional reforms, like the qualification system of consultants was reformed several times by the government and the quasi-government organizations to increase the supply of services and also to maintain the quality of trainers. So these reforms are considered to be successful in Japan. And in Singapore or other East Asian countries, the diffusion process was much more, you know, top-down, the government-led type diffusion process. In the case of Singapore, so it started in around 1960, but as late as 1981, Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew found the productivity level is so low, so he ordered institutional reforms. And then the JICA and the people asked to find out the cause, and then it took a few years, but they found that those knowledge brought to the Singapore was too abstract, and then didn't have any impact on enterprises. So that would be a reason why the spread was so slow. And then after that, the more practical ideas, also the training was redesigned, and then it was a breakthrough, and after that it was went very well. And Botswana, so Sam Jones said Botswana has a very high education level, and then they are going ahead, has been going ahead in terms of the, you know, diffusion of productivity movement. They learned from Singapore. Well, now Ethiopia is very serious about adopting this kind of thing. They're adopting Kaizen. So they say Kaizen would be the, you know, core of their modernization movement. But their system is, again, very, very much top-down. So I wonder if they can meet the increasing demand for the, you know, training service or consulting services. So there would be a lot of institutional reforms. So it seems critically important for business people in developing countries to learn about management and start the productivity movement. So, but what management style works well will depend on the culture of each society. So there should be Ghanaian or Ethiopian or Tanzanian versions of Kaizen. Similarly, institutional arrangements for promoting the productivity movement should be different in different countries. But they are not totally different, because successful institutions toward the spread of productivity movement should have the commonality, because they must address these market failure problems. First is that those who need to learn do not know the value of learning. So then the second problem would be the asymmetric information between the, you know, people who want to sell the knowledge and those who want to buy the knowledge. And also there would be a second mover advantage or imitator's advantage, which reduces incentive to be the first mover. So government or any institutional reforms have to address this kind of problems. But so far, I don't have any concrete policy recommendations. I did some kind of training, experiments to see the impact. But I don't know what will happen if we, you know, scale up that kind of project. And then because of the very limited administrative capacity of the government, so even if the prime minister really pushed the movement, so the government officials couldn't follow. And then already lots of problems are happening in Ethiopia. So I wonder if the Tanzania tried to expand the project, then what, I don't know what would happen. So we need to study much more about this kind of thing. Thank you very much.